One of my students tried to build a model to predict how many points an NFL team would score per game based on the team's offensive stats. He plugged in, for example, passing yards, rushing yards, and total offensive yards as inputs. But the program broke. It wouldn't give him an answer. Just infinite solutions and error messages. So why was that? The data was correct, everything looked good, but he missed one crucial thing. This kind of problem is mathematically similar to many other problems we've mentioned before. We call these best approximation problems. And if we can find a way to solve this problem in general, then we can apply the strategy to all those situations and more. This strategy hinges on one powerful idea my student didn't understand: linear independence. Each of these different problems can be represented mathematically in the same way. Each has a matrix of vectors, a vector of scalars from the linear combinations, and a goal vector. In each of these situations, we know the vectors in the matrix, which is our data, like the responses to the preference survey or nutritional facts or different foods. The columns of this matrix are what we refer to as basis vectors, and we also know the goal vector. What we don't know is the values in the vector of scalars. We can write this problem symbolically as this approximation expression, with a matrix multiplication on the left-hand side, since the matrix multiplication is shorthand, or a linear combination of vectors. So we need to find out how much to scale each of these basis vectors to best approximate the goal vector. We discussed a general strategy on how to solve this problem in a previous video, where we learned a simple way to compress audio. A link to the video is in the description. We will give a quick recap to the general strategy, since it's important to understand and uses many fundamental linear algebra ideas. The general strategy for a best approximation problem is to consider the geometry of all linear combinations of basis vectors, or in other words, the span of the basis vectors. In our previous examples, we found that the linear combination of one vector was a line and two vectors was a plane, or said differently, that the span of one vector was a line and the span of two vectors was a plane. With that, we could find the point on the line or plane that's closest to our goal vector by dropping a perpendicular from the head of the goal vector to the line or plane. The combination of basis vectors that gets us to that projected vector is the solution to our problem. But in the previous audio compression video, when we've taken this approach, we had orthogonal basis vectors, which led to a simple solution. But that will not be the case here, since we don't get to construct our basis vectors. So will any set of basis vectors work? Let's use the food example to make sense of what is going on. We've seen in previous videos that the more food basis vectors I add, the closer I tend to get to my goal vector. When projecting the goal vector onto the span of one food, in this case, peanut butter, I get this. And when projecting the goal vector onto the span of two food vectors, peanut butter and bread, we can get this close to the goal vector, which is much closer. Now it seems like there is a pattern here. The span of one basis vector was one-dimensional. The span of two vectors was two-dimensional. Will the span of three vectors always be three-dimensional and four vectors always be four-dimensional? Or did we just get lucky with our vectors, that they just happened to make this pattern? Maybe two different vectors could produce a span of three dimensions or one dimension. To understand the situation, let's suppose you want to get closer to your ideal diet by changing the amount and types of food you eat in your diet. You could choose servings of jam, or you could choose as your other food a simple peanut butter sandwich with two slices of bread and one serving of peanut butter. Either way, we can now have three basis vectors to approximate our goal vector. Which of these is better? Well, let's explore the jam situation first. If the pattern holds, the span of these three vectors will be a three-dimensional space, or what some would call a three-dimensional hyperplane. But since our goal vector lives in a three-dimensional space of protein, fat, and carbs, we should be able to create our goal vector exactly with the linear combination of peanut butter, bread, and jam. We could test this by rewriting our linear combination as a system of equations and solving that system. Putting the system into Wolfram Alpha quickly confirms our intuition, and here is the solution. If we change our diet by this amount of peanut butter servings, this amount of bread servings, and this amount of jam servings, then we will reach our goal. Okay, let's try the same thing with a peanut butter sandwich instead of jam. Assuming the same pattern holds, the span of these should be a three-dimensional space, like before, and we should be able to find and create our goal vector exactly from these basis vectors. We throw the system of equations into Wolfram Alpha and find that something is wrong. There's no solution. So what is going on? Well, let's go back and look at the span of these sets of basis vectors. Running through a bunch of scalars for peanut butter, bread, and jam vectors points to being able to fill the protein, fat, and carb space. But running through a bunch of scalars for the peanut butter, bread, and sandwich vectors still seems to only span a plane, not a three-dimensional space. Why would adding the jam vector be different than adding the sandwich vector? Well, there are a few different ways to understand this. First, algebraically, no matter what combination of peanut butter, bread, and sandwich vectors we have, we can rewrite the combination as just a combination of peanut butter and bread, because a peanut butter sandwich is just a linear combination of peanut butter and bread. Every vector we can create with a linear combination of peanut butter, bread, and sandwich can also be made with just peanut butter and bread vectors. So the sandwich vector is just redundant information. Geometrically, the vector represented by the peanut butter sandwich is already in the plane spanned by the peanut butter and bread vectors, so adding it in as a basis vector doesn't increase the span of vectors and doesn't get us any closer to our goal vector. Adding the jam vector to the peanut butter and bread vector is different. The jam vector cannot be made by the combination of peanut butter and bread vectors. This increases the span of the vectors with jam added, because it allows more values of protein, fat, and carbs to be reached. In fact, any value of protein, fat, and carb can be reached with these three vectors. So our strategy for solving best approximation problems has a caveat. It seems that in order for the dimension of the span to equal the number of vectors, none of our basis vectors can be the linear combination of others. Mathematicians call this property linear independence. A set of vectors where no vector is a linear combination of the others is a linearly independent set of vectors. If at least one of them can be written as a linear combination of the other ones, it is called a linearly dependent set. This is one of the most important ideas in linear algebra. Sets that are independent vectors have different properties, and usually nicer properties, than sets with dependent vectors. Let's find out how to decide if a set is independent or dependent, and then I will discuss a little more about how it impacts the best approximation problems. To test if a vector is independent from others, we can try expressing it as a linear combination of the other vectors. We've already seen that a peanut butter sandwich is just one peanut butter serving and two bread servings, so if added, it makes the set of those three vectors a dependent set. And when we add jam instead, we get no solution, so they're independent. But hold on, jam is also independent of peanut butter and, let's say, a vector three times the peanut butter vector. And that set is definitely dependent because one is just a multiple of the other. So do we have to test every vector against the rest of the vectors in the same way? Well, there is a strategy that cuts down on the work. It's solving this system of equations, where we try to make the zero vector with the basis vectors. One thing to notice about this equation is that there is always a solution. If the scalars or coefficients are all zeros, then this is a true equation. But there might be other solutions. If there's a solution where there are non-zero coefficients, then the set is dependent. If there's only the zero solution, then the set is independent. One way to convince yourself of this is that if there are non-zero coefficients, then you can solve for one of the vectors with non-zero coefficients and have a formula for creating that vector as a linear combination of other vectors. Now, you can't do the same thing if all coefficients must be zero, unless you're Chuck Norris, because you end up having to divide by zero. Using this equation, we can now find shortcuts to know if one or two vectors are independent of each other. The only way for one vector to have a non-zero solution is if the vector is the zero vector, a fact professors often test on an exam. For two vectors, the only way for them to be dependent is if one is the zero vector or one is a scalar multiple of the other. These are easy to test without intense calculations, but in general, testing three or more vectors takes more work. In practice, with three or more vectors, we usually set up this matrix with the columns of the matrix as the vectors that we're testing and use a technique called row reduction to get the matrix into a special form called row-reduced echelon form. I won't go into the process to do that here. There are probably a million videos on YouTube already on that topic. But here's the info that we need. Echelon means level and is related to the words escalate and escalator. We can see that there is a step structure with the zeros in the row-reduced echelon form. A column that only has a 1 in it is independent of all other columns with only 1s in them. These are called leading 1s. If all columns have leading 1s, then all basis vectors are independent. You may have learned to augment a matrix when using row reduction to solve a system of equations. But we don't have to augment the matrix with a column of zeros, because the row reduction process will keep that column of zeros, and we only care about leading ones in the other columns. We are starting to see why linearly independent sets are nice. The dimension of the span of the set is equal to the number of vectors in a linearly independent set. But what happens when the set isn't independent? Things get messier. Redundancy creeps in, and suddenly the solutions to our vector problems are no longer unique. There seems to be an optimal set of vectors, one that spans the space that we're interested in, but without redundancy. Peanut butter bread and jam do just that. They can make any goal vector in our protein, fat, and carb space. And moreover, that solution is unique. There's only one, no ambiguity. This optimal set of vectors is called a basis, a set of linearly independent vectors that spans the space we're interested in. Now, I've already been using the idea of basis as the set of vectors we use to create or approximate goal vectors. This still fits with an intuitive idea of basis, because we use basis vectors as building blocks to create or approximate other vectors. But to technically qualify as a basis, the vectors must be independent. And depending on the space we care about, we might need to add more vectors to our set to fully span the space we care about. For an intuitive example of a basis, we can look at the visible color spectrum. The colors red, green, and blue are a basis for the visible color spectrum, and a combination of these three colors is what most screens use to make different colors. If we add another color like yellow, then we still could make all the colors, but there would be many different ways to reach each color because this is not an independent set. Red and green light make yellow light, and that's complexity we would rather not have to deal with. If we take away a color, so we just use, say, red and blue, then we can't make all colors, for example, yellow and green. The span of red and blue colors is not the visible color spectrum. And here's why all this actually matters. If you're not careful about independence and bases, then you can end up in trouble. Remember the student I mentioned at the beginning, the one building a model to predict points per game in the NFL from offensive stats? Well, in his model, he had passing yards, rushing yards, and total offensive yards. Now, all you need to know about American football for this example is that the total offensive yards is created by adding the passing and rushing yards together, since these are the only two ways to move the ball. But this makes these three vectors a dependent set, so he kept getting infinite solutions and the program he was using to do the calculation wouldn't give him an answer. If you've taken a stats course, you might recognize that some of the problems that we've been using are actually regression problems. And you might remember your professor warning, don't use linearly dependent vectors when you're creating a regression model. And this is why. Dependent vectors as inputs into a regression problem lead to infinite solutions, and regression programs will give you an error or give you garbage. So yes, linear independence might seem abstract, but it's at the core of building solid models, solving clean systems, and understanding the math behind everything from sandwiches to sports. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.